So welcome to worship. A couple of brief announcements. We made a change into one of our little technical administrative things last week, and it worked really well, so we've kept on doing that. If you have a scheduled speaking part in the service, you are a co-host, so you should be able to unmute yourself. Today, that's Gene, Benjamin and Tricia, Granger, and the Van Dyke Evans crew is my count on that. So you should be able to unmute yourself when the time comes for you to do whatever you are scheduled to do in the service. Next Sunday, the preachers will be in Lithuania. So we'll get to see them. Session is in consultation right now about how we begin a hybrid, some people in the building, some people on Zoom, worship model for our folks who have really struggled with getting on Zoom. So you'll expect to hear that, more about that over the next week or two, and we may need you to help us test, because me and Madeline testing is not as thorough a test as we get on Sunday morning and things like that for volume levels and a bunch of other things that sort of need to be tested. So please watch your email or your text messages for messages about possible testing and things. We will intentionally not be asking just the tech junkies to test, because it needs to work for everybody. So those sorts of things. The blessing box is up. It is on a post. It has some things in it. Watch your email this week for lists of things that can go in the blessing box. I was hoping I'd see Ron's face on here today, and maybe we'll later. He was concerned that the seal on the door might not keep water out. I can inform him with confidence that after the rain of the last 2 days, the seal on the door works just fine. It is bone dry inside of the blessing box. It is by the northern handicap parking spaces on the driveway so that folks can pull in, get out of their car, get what they need, and then get going again. So those sorts of things. The Tuesday morning group is still going to meet. They're meeting in the fellowship hall, 6, 8, 7.5, something like that, feet apart typically, and have had a group from anywhere from, say, 3 to, say, 7 or 8 people. I think they're really wishing that we had the weather from about 3 weeks ago of 72 and sunny to go back outside to. Book group is on Zoom on Wednesday morning. Watch your email for that invite. The link is the same as it has been in the last couple weeks for that meeting, those sorts of things. We did have a little drama here this week where we found that 60-year-old pipes sometimes come apart. I know for those of you who have 60-year-old parts, that's not a surprise, but that is now fixed and resolved. Water is flowing at the church again, and we have some bright new copper pipes in the men's room. The floor still needs to be mopped really well. It's got a lot of dust that turned to mud as a result of that, but that has been resolved at the moment, and we're moving forward with water and things like that. So all of those are good things. I want to thank each of you who responded to your deacon. We got that information from the deacons as a session Friday or Saturday, and we're putting that together so that we can provide the best care and the best worship environment with safety and concern for people both being involved and people not being anxious about being involved all at the same time. Our biggest challenge on Sunday morning is actually Sunday school, because those are small groups where we tend to get very close and be right up on each other and talk with vigor and energy. And so that will probably stay on Zoom a little while longer because we don't quite have the room to spread out. We are looking at the options of layout in the sanctuary and things like that, because currently we would have somebody every other row at alternate ends of the long pews, and then we'd still need to skip a pew to keep the 6 feet spacing. And so we needed the family sizes and things like that so that we could see what was possible and what is not possible safely. Watch either your snail mail inbox or your email inbox for more information about that stuff as we go forward. We are working on it. None of us had really intended on signing up for session and becoming infectious disease controls. Jan Collins left us early. We were really well prepared for a number of years with an infection control specialist on session, and now she's in Iowa, so those sorts of things. But we're working on that. It's taking a lot more energy than all of us would like at this point, but our goal is to include as many folks in worship as possible while not starting a new COVID ministry at the same time. So those are the sorts of things that we have. This is indeed week 4 on the Lord's Prayer, so this is going to wrap up this series. Next week is worship brought to us from LCC International University in Klaipėda, Lithuania. All the things that we thought were really too hard to do 6 months ago are now just happening. And so now let us worship God. I believe Benjamin has our introit. Gene, you're still muted for some reason.
When I hold this space bar down, I'm on.
If you hold it down, you'll be on. You should be able to click the microphone in that bottom left-hand corner and unmute yourself.
I'll just hold a space bar. How's that be? Please join me in the call to worship. In the dark print is for you. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
All my inmost being.
Praise
his holy name.
Praise the Lord, O my soul.
And forget
not all his benefits. Who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases. Who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion. Praise the Lord, O my soul.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Our hymn of praise is 396, verses 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you.
Join me with a call of confession. In spite of God's love and the gift of love to us, we often act in destructive and hateful ways. We close our hearts to God and disobey God's law. Together, let us confess our sins. Forgive us our sins, O Lord. Forgive us the sins of our youth and the sins of our age, the sins of our soul and the sins of our body, our secret and our whispering sins, our presumptuous and our careless sins, the sins we have done to please ourselves, and the sins we have done to please others. Forgive us the sins that we know and the sins that we do not know.
Forgive them,
O Lord. Forgive them all because of your great goodness. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
All right. That brings us... we've done a little bit about mission with the Blessing Box. That's a project that came out of Sharks, a little free pantry to go with a little free library. Zion and First Methodist have them already, and they call them Blessing Boxes, so we renamed ours so that everything would sound similar. We're in a unique position in town here by the high school. A lot of road traffic, particularly now that Halfway Road is connected, a lot of foot traffic. And so we thought this was a way that we could serve folks in our community. Kids hungry at the end of the day, folks walking through with some non-perishable snacks, some hygiene products, and some bottles of water, things like that. So that's why it's there and that's what it's for. Food pantries aren't always accessible. We get calls at weird hours or calls when the Ministerial Alliance is closed, and this allows us to help meet the needs of some of our neighbors. John Holst and John Hackman, the pastors at Zion and First United Methodist, both assure me that theirs get plenty of use and that they feel no guilt for not filling it up more than once a week or once every 2 weeks. So we will see how our traffic is. When we originally started this project, we were going to have kids at the high school in the spring and in the summer and in the fall. And so now things are a little different. But this is just one of those ways that we are still at mission and at ministry in our community. So brings us to our first lesson, which is from the 16th chapter of the book of Exodus. the whole congregation of the Israelites set out from Elam. And Israel came to the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month, after they had departed from the land of Aaron, from the land of Egypt. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, for you have brought us out into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I'm going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for that day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt, and in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you complain against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining." Friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our second lesson is then from the third chapter of the letter to Colossians. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience. Bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, to which indeed you were called in the one body. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. Teach and admonish one another in all wisdom. And with gratitude in your hearts, sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs to God. And whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. We are coming to the end of our series on the Lord's Prayer. And this week is our needs. And as we've noticed from the past couple weeks, Jesus crams an awful lot of meaning and content into this short, tiny little prayer. We did not get away with anything and have a lighter week this week. If anything, there's even more. So there's essentially three clauses that Jesus gives us towards the end of the prayer that address our needs. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. Then we close with a benediction. There's a piece to this that we know very, very well because we pray this prayer an awful lot. Every Sunday, we pray this prayer. Probably, if you are having a hard time in your life and you don't know what else to pray, you pull this prayer out because you know this one. If you have remnants of a Catholic upbringing, you have probably said the Our Father many times, particularly post-confession. And so here we are in a prayer that we know really well that perhaps we haven't really investigated as well as we should have because we know it so well. Give us this day our daily bread. To me, that immediately harkens back to that passage in Exodus about manna. Now, there's a couple things going on when we make that connection. One is that the people are whiny. Like, that's how we get into that whole narrative is, well, it would have been better if you just let us die in Egypt as slaves than bring us out here and starve us to death. And so God says to the people, fine, you'll have meat in the morning and bread in the evening, or the other way around, bread in the morning and meat in the evening, and I'm going to make it happen. But you only get to take as much as you need for today. That's the commandment, is just take what you need for today. And so the manna in the wilderness is, on a very basic level, daily bread. On the sixth day of the week, they were to take enough to get them through the Sabbath. And anybody who took too much found it didn't do them any good. It rotted. It got wormy. It got nasty by the next morning. We think about that when it comes to, do I have enough food to eat for today? Do I have enough to get through today? And that's a very physical interpretation of it. It's also a spiritual interpretation to it. One of the most commonly used daily devotionals in our part of the Christian church is known as Daily Bread. Do not eat the devotional. It is not advised to do it that way. But we do need nourishment of the spiritual type each and every day. We need God's presence. We need the experience of God in our lives every day. And that's a piece of this prayer, this little clause in this prayer. There's also a piece to it about us believing that God will do it again tomorrow, and the day after, and the day after, and the day after. This prayer is not just, Lord, put enough food in the refrigerator for today, but also, Lord, help me believe that you are giving me what I need each and every day. And so part of the challenge for us is to read this not like it's a pandemic era, once a week grocery shopping trip to be dropped off at the front door, but a daily, ongoing, continuous action by God so that we have what we need for each and every day. Daily bread, delivered early, often, continuing, persisting, pushing through. Reading this clause about daily bread as an ongoing action of God, not just an ongoing request from us, changes then how we read the next two clauses. It's almost like Jesus wanted us to think about this when we prayed it. And so the next clause is, forgive us, and this is where Christians differ, our debts, our sins, our trespasses, as we forgive our debtors, our sinners, and those who trespass against us. Okay? So large quantities of things going on there. The sense of things there is that Presbyterians and Reformed people say debts. The snide comment about that is because we know how to pinch a penny and we're very concerned with money. The perhaps a little more sacredly focused is that that's actually the word Matthew uses in Matthew's gospel. Other churches will use sins or trespasses. Each of them has language that's valuable to think about. Trespasses is a very concrete thing. We see, well, almost every day if you drive around the countryside in southern Illinois, you will see a no trespassing sign. And you know what it means. Don't step on my stuff. Don't get in my stuff. And we know that one of the most common ways we offend one another is we get in each other's stuff. We do something somebody else thought they had handled. We step into their work territory. We interfere in their lives. We provide input that was not requested nor desired. We trespass. We're really good at it. So we should be familiar with it. And other people do it to us as well, because the we that's really good at trespassing is the human race. And so trespasses has a certain level of power, of concreteness to getting us to think about what we have done and what we need to forgive. Sins does as well. It's a really theological word. It has a sense of evil, of wrongdoing, of being unfaithful. The Pauline version of it is missing the mark. And so there is a sense of that that's ongoing, that we can find some comfort, comfort's the wrong word, some familiarity with the word sin and the need to have our sin forgiven and the idea that we should forgive the sin of our neighbor and those who sin against us. And then there's the Presbyterian, Scottish, Dutch Reformed debts. Well, for a long time, the church has used the conversation about salvation as a kind of cash exchange, that Jesus paid the price for us. More than that, though, as we talked about in Sunday school this morning, there is a sense in our common English that if you do something nice for me, I will say, I owe you one. Right? I'm in your debt. This is not to say that God is the First Savings Bank of Heaven Incorporated, and you go in and ask for a loan to cover all of your debts for the next 5 years and hopefully cash out. But the sense that we understand what it is to owe something to somebody else, to be indebted. And that sometimes being indebted can be uncomfortable. Sometimes we really want to strive to pay off that debt. And sometimes that our indebtedness is what keeps us in relationship, because we have to be in relationship with somebody we owe that much to. I want you to consider this, though, this request as not a, like we do this weekly, or we do this annually, or we pray this once, God forgive me as I forgive others. This too is an ongoing daily act of devotion. To be forgiven is something we have a need of daily, as much as we need the physical daily bread. To forgive others is something that we need to be doing daily and in an ongoing, perpetual fashion. Because if we do not forgive others, A, what happens to us? You ever turned into a bitter person because you couldn't forgive somebody? You ever been, again, in pre-pandemic days, been at Kroger and you're going down the aisle and you see that person and you turn your cart around and go down the other aisle, right? Being unforgiven or being unforgiving has a daily cost and a daily price attached to it. It modifies how we live and move and have our being. And so we need to remember to be people who are concerned both with being forgiven and with forgiving on an ongoing, regular, habitual basis. Now, we had a lot of debate about the third clause in Sunday school. The one that we all have memorized, because we're all old fogies here, is lead me not into temptation and deliver us from evil, right? The newer version, which you'll find in your bulletin, is save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. So, first of all, what is our sense that God is the one who leads us into temptation? That can be a little problematic. I don't imagine Jesus going, hey, Wade, come over here. Let's see if you can withstand this temptation. Right? I mean, is that really how we envision God? I have a bookmark at home that I've had since I was a teenager, and it says in that old English script, Lord, lead me not into temptation. I can find it by myself. We can find temptation, right? So this request on some levels in the old language is lead us not someplace we already know how to go. Lead us someplace different. And we hear that in save us from the time of trial as well. We all have trials and we're all gonna have trials. If you figure out a way to get out of trials, you can probably write a mass-produced, multi-million-dollar selling book and be at the top of the New York Times bestseller list for years. So if you figure that out, more power to you. Until then, we're going to have trials. And we're going to have tribulations, to use another one of those great old-fashioned Bible words. And the question then is, what do we do in them? I think there is a reason that Jesus pairs save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil, because it is in those times of trial and in those times of temptation that evil often wins. Not just in one decision, but it grabs and bites and holds on to a piece of our hearts and our minds and our souls. And evil does not give it up. Now, some of you may be surprised to hear a Presbyterian talking so candidly about evil, because we normally want to dismiss evil as something like the devil in a pitchfork suit and horns and just call it good. Evil's real. And part of Jesus including it in this prayer is demanding us to recognize evil as real, in a daily, ongoing, routine level. If you have ever had the conversation with somebody about why you don't tell a lie, right? We have the whole integrity and honesty thing, and we probably have invoked the mythical George Washington and his cherry tree in telling that story. But also, as soon as you tell a lie, we tell the story that you have to tell another one, and another one, and another one, and another one. And pretty soon, we have spent so much time and energy maintaining the lie that we have forgotten the truth. Is it really worth that much energy versus telling our parents we went to the movies? And that carries over in other aspects of our lives. Once we get in the habit of giving in to temptation and evil, it becomes easier and easier and easier to do it. So save us from that time of trial. Don't let us live there in perpetuity, and deliver us from the real, true power of evil. I want you to note that delivering us from evil, saving us from the time of trial, doesn't mean that life is a bed of roses. It means that God is consistently present with us in our struggles. It's really what the prayer request is for somebody to save me, they need to be here. For somebody to deliver me, I'm not a pizza, but they need to be able to walk with me, take me by the hand, and carry me out. And so for us to take that part seriously, evil has to be real. Temptation and trial have to be real. And the presence of God in the world has to be real. We as human beings, all of us, have often gotten to the point where we tell convenient stories that are not the truth, but it's easier to tell them because everybody knows them and we move on. This is, in our day and in our time, a challenge for us to be removed from temptation and delivered from evil, to tell the truth. To live with integrity is an ongoing daily challenge. And so if we read this clause again as a daily, ongoing, perpetual, continual request of us to God, it's not like, whew, God delivered me from that huge temptation. Now I'm done. God is with us each and every day in every challenge, in every trial, in every temptation, in every time that evil tries to get a hold of us, and every time that we let evil grab a hold of us, God is with us. And we pray for that to be true, and we pray to remember that. Now, all of these three lumped together are powerful, because think of all the things Jesus could ask us to pray about. I mean, think about our varied prayer requests on a Sunday morning. There is really not a prayer of thanksgiving included in the Lord's Prayer. There is really not a request for healing. There is certainly not a request that anybody's ball team win the big game. And there are no requests for 8-year-old girls to get ponies for their birthday. These may all appear in our own prayer lives, but they don't appear in the prayer that Jesus teaches us. So I think it's worth a particular look at these three. These are what Jesus thinks we need. We need enough for today. And we need to trust that tomorrow there will be enough for tomorrow. Not just that there will be enough, but that God will again provide tomorrow. We need to be serious about the business of forgiveness, our own and our neighbor's. We need to understand sin and debt and trespasses for both the cancers that they are, that eat us up from the inside, and that they are something we have the power to cure by both asking for forgiveness and by granting forgiveness. And that the model we have for that is Jesus. And then the last piece is that life is going to be a challenge. There are going to be trials and temptations, and evil is real, and we are going to encounter actual evil as we move through the world as followers of Jesus Christ. We need to believe that God will be with us in all of those encounters, in all of those trials, and in all of those temptations. And that God will not only be present with us, but will save us and deliver us from them. I'm going to use another cancer analogy here. And for those of you who've been through it, you know what I mean. We often have a cure for cancer. It's not pleasant. There is no promise that being saved and delivered from the time of trial and from evil is going to be a fun journey. We are promised it will be a faithful journey. We will not go on alone. And that's really part of what we need, is to know that we are not alone. So the we language in the prayer is important. Forgive us as we forgive our. Deliver us, lead us not into temptation. Because it is an us thing. We are the beloved children, the people of God. It is an us thing. And so we will close this as Jesus instructs us to close the prayer with a benediction that is hopeful and aspirational and a good reminder of where we stand on the pecking order. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. To God alone be the glory, this day and forevermore. Amen. So friends, our affirmation of faith today comes from the new study catechism, which is only about 20 years old now. And this is the kids' version, and it walks through each clause. And so here are three questions and answers. The bold type is yours. Why do we pray, give us today our daily bread? Because all good things come from God. Even in our most ordinary needs, God cares for us completely. What do we ask when we pray, forgive us our sins? Telling God we are sorry. We ask God not to hold our sins against us, but to accept us again by grace. Why do we continue with, as we forgive those who sin against us? Because we are to forgive others, just as God has forgiven us. What do we ask when we pray, save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil? We ask God to protect us, especially when we most need it. We pray for God to free us from all desires that would lead us to sin and to shelter us from the powers of evil that may threaten us. Friends, we've come to that part of the service where we gather our gifts and our prayers before God. As the offertory is played, I invite you to think about the things that you are offering up to God this day. We do continue to need your gifts to operate the church and to be the church in the world. So we pray that you will continue giving those through all of the fun ways we have to do that, online or mailing it in or however that works. So please do that. And please be in prayer about the prayers we will lift up and the offerings we give. Thank you. Now we come to that time where we gather our prayer requests together. I will ask you to wave at us if you have a prayer request, and we will go around and hopefully get everybody. Then let's pray. Dear God, we come to you this day because we have learned to trust in you for our daily bread. We have learned that you do give us what we need a day at a time, and sometimes an hour and a minute at a time. And that when this minute, this hour, and this day are done, you have not left us. You are standing with us. And so we come to you this day with prayers that revolve around your people, the things that keep us apart and the things that draw us together, and the common ground we have in you. So we pray, O God, for those names that we have lifted up, for situations of health and work and travel, baptism, for work that feels undone and rushed, for voices that we seem not to listen to, yet we know that you hear, O God. For the work of your people as we struggle to be faithful, that you would indeed lead us not into temptation and save us from trial and deliver us from evil. We come to you this day, O God, because we have slowly learned to get that our prayers are not at high points and low points. Our prayers are everyday conversation with a God who loves us and will not leave us. And so we come to you. We come to you with uncertainty. We come to you with awe and wonder. We come to you with hope and joy. We come to you with fear and doubt. And we come to you with faith and love. Hear us this day as we pray, perhaps a little slower, perhaps with a little more meaning, the prayer that you taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Friends, as you go out into the world, as the world opens up, whether you go out into it or not, may you go with the prayer of Jesus on your lips, acknowledging the God who is holy, the God whose rule and whose reign we await and desire, the God who is with us each and every day, giving us what we need for today, and who accompanies us in forgiveness, in temptation, in distress, and in trial. Go and know that you are not alone in this or in anything, and that as the body of Christ, we go with one another, with our neighbors and our world, to provide daily bread, forgiveness, and company for travel in trial, temptation, and deliverance. Friends, go, and may the love of God, the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit be with us and abide with us this day and forevermore. Amen.
Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. This day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power.